Primary production underwriting for Check Please Kansas City has been provided by Bank of America, Bank of Opportunity. Additional funding for Check Please Kansas City is provided by 360 Vodka, the world's first eco-friendly premium vodka, saving the planet one glass at a time.
You know, I'm a seafood junkie.
Let's talk dessert.
Banana split.
I don't ever remember taking anything home. I eat the whole thing.
They're never ending. You can never get to the bottom of them.
It was just fantastic. Yeah, it was very, very good.
Pumpkin ravioli, it's a disgusting food. It's a disgusting vegetable.
What was more unusual was I thoroughly enjoyed it.
It's become like a home away from home. I have to admit, it's off the beaten path.
Way off the beaten path.
Yeah, it is.
Yes, perfect.
Hello, I'm Doug Frost, and welcome to Check Please Kansas City, the show where regular folks from all over Kansas City dine and dish on their favorite restaurants. This is how the show works. Every week, we have three guests. Each recommends his or her favorite spot, while the other two go and check them out to see what they think. This week, high school English teacher Lindsay McFall says your assignment is to use only three adjectives and one adverb to describe her pick in Waldo. Retail sales associate Susan Smith says you'll not only get great customer service, but great food at her pick off the Plaza. And now, college professor Jacob Bosch says you don't need a doctorate to understand the emphasis on local ingredients delivered in a sleek but approachable package, and that's what makes 715 superlative.
And we opened 715 in fall of 2009.
We set out to create a place that was more of a neighborhood eatery. Just, we want people to feel comfortable here. I have a background, a lot of Italian cuisine. We're not really traditional Italian, but I just try to use that philosophy as far as like, you know, fresh local ingredients. We get our meat locally, and then weather permitting, season permitting, we get our vegetables locally as well.
Extremely important to us to know the growers and know the farmers, know how the food is handled from the farm to the table. I mean, that's a cliche term now, but farm to table is really, I think, the wave of the future. As businesses and conglomerates get bigger and bigger and bigger, I think people are starting to look to focus things back down, both for health and for the environment and for kind of downshifting a little bit. Instead of just 24/7, go, 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 eat in your car, like, come on in, sit down. You can have, you know, a glass of wine if you want. You can have a pizza. We're here to enable people to have a good time, and I hope people take advantage of us in that way.
Jacob, clearly it's academic why you like 715. Tell us more.
I like 715 because the proprietor has a lot of self-made products, and he has a strong dedication to pigs. So even if you even if you don't think that something like head cheese would be for you, I think you could go into this place and sort of eat outside your comfort zone a little bit and not be turned off by weird flavors or, you know, any sort of pretension. I think that it fills a niche that college students and professors alike all want, because they offer a sort of budget menu alongside a very high-end peasant food fit for a king menu, which is the words that the owner uses.
Yeah. What piggy parts are you looking for when you go to 715?
So every time you go, there's always salumi plates, and he makes his own mortadella, which is fabulous. And for people who don't know, mortadella is like adult bologna, right? It has fat in it and pistachios, but it's also very silky and has that natural sweetness that pork does too. Also, he does a thing called a porchetta, and his version of it is quite good. Maybe not as good as what you'd find in Italy, but I give him an A for effort.
So when you're there, any particular desserts, any particular appetizers other than the salumi?
He does rabbit, and I think that any restaurant that does rabbit is worth paying attention to. But the emphasis there is on picking products that are both heritage and products that are local, right? So on his menu, he describes where he's getting all of these things from, whether it's his beef or his butter or his pork and so on and so forth.
Cool. Well, how about you, Lindsay? Would you have any pig parts there?
I did not. I actually had salmon.
Ah, I see. The swimming pig part.
Swimming pig, yeah. So it was one of the specials that night, and it was just a simple sautéed salmon with a local apple salad, which I really, really liked.
Well, how about you, Susan?
We went for lunch.
because we made a little day trip up there, so we went for lunch, and I really, really liked it. My brother-in-law did have the spaghetti and meatballs, and the meatballs are all pork. I thought their sauce was fabulous. I really did. Really liked it.
How would you describe it?
It was thick. It wasn't one. You know, some sauces when you go to a restaurant, they're watery. This wasn't watery at all. It was really thick and flavorful.
Too.
And then I had the chicken salad. It was the most unusual chicken salad I've ever had because it wasn't mayonnaise based. It was blended with sun-dried tomatoes, and it was very, very good. But the desserts were what I absolutely loved. We had the strawberry shortcake, and their presentation is beautiful. We also had the apple crumb cake, and it was served, the ice cream that was served with that was on a little tiny bed of meringue. And it
That's
was such a nice touch. When you, I just really thought that was just a special little, not a touch that you would have to do, but just something that made it special.
It's a little crunch at the bottom of the
And
thing.
One of the things that we noticed, there were a lot of professor types in there, and I thought,
I
this is really interesting.
I think you've been sussed out.
I think so,
I took my
yeah.
own professor there, yeah. so.
And I loved the divider that was in the restaurant that was made of green bottles.
Oh, yeah.
I thought that was really, really
Pellegrino
pretty.
Bottles.
But no, we really enjoyed our visit there. It was very, very nice.
Yes. Well, Lindsay, any thoughts about the way the layout of the restaurant at
yeah,
all?
Yeah, this is like my dream of what a restaurant should look like on the inside. I loved it. It was really modern with an urban feel, but it wasn't cold.
Mm-hmm.
And I also love the idea of having an open kitchen. So I think that says a lot about the chef and how confident he is in his cooking. So I loved the decor inside.
Mm-hmm. And bang for the buck. I mean, Lindsay, do you think it's worth the drive? Is it a good enough value to get you on, you know, Highway 10 or Highway 7?
I think that we would make another trip there. The service, our waitress was amazing.
Yeah, indeed. So. Bang for the buck. What do you think, Jacob?
Almost all the entrees are under $20, and that's hard to find in KCMO. You can eat multiple courses and not break the bank.
And how about you, Susan? Bang for the buck.
I thought it was very reasonable. My only problem was when we got in there, they talked about a lunch special they had, which is, I think, $7.15, which makes sense, for a pasta and a salad. And I must have not made it clear when we ordered, because what we got was just an entree for $7.99, $8.99, whatever it was. But there wasn't a salad. So I don't really quite understand how that worked. It wasn't a big issue. It was the only thing that I was just confused.
Yeah.
That was all.
Well, Jacob, your restaurant, sum it up for us.
I think if you want to take a day trip to Lawrence, going to 715 is a great idea because you're going to get value for money. You're going to get this cutting-edge cuisine with people who care about the product that they're creating. They care about where they're getting their ingredients from. Beyond all of that, I feel like the menu touches a lot of bases that you wouldn't find in other Italian restaurants. And to me, that's what makes it exemplary.
Indeed. Well, Lindsay?
I agree. I really enjoyed my trip to 715. I was very excited to see the menu online. So I would go again.
Cool. And Susan?
I was impressed by the variety. Like, say, you know, the tuna spaghetti. I mean, you don't see that everywhere. Yeah, I would definitely go again.
Well, great. Well, try it for yourself at 715 Restaurant in Lawrence, Kansas. Their phone number is 785-856-7150. They're open Monday through Friday, 11 a.m. to midnight, Saturday and Sunday, 9 a.m. to midnight. Reservations are accepted, and the average dinner tab per person without drinks is $20. Retail sales associate Susan Smith describes her pick as an English pub with a decidedly southern flair for food, but named after a British fight promoter, Jack Gage.
Jack Gage American Tavern is a modern interpretation of a classic American tavern. Nostalgia with a new twist. Jack Gage was a boxing promoter and showman back in the 1920s, turn of the century, in England. We obtained P pieces of his boxing emporium, where he would, that was his venue for boxing matches that traveled across the countryside in England. Our culinary director, Chef Richard McPeak, created menus that represent about seven different regions of American cuisine. Our top appetizer is a fried green tomato tower with lump crab meat. We go throughout the South picking up dishes such as shrimp and grits, chicken and waffles. It all sounds very hearty, but we also have menu items that go to the lighter side as well. We've filled a niche here in Kansas City, doing a lot of things, not just taking the best dishes from other restaurants that surround us, but trying to innovate and bring back something that stirs emotion in people.
Susan, tell us a little more about Jack Gage American Tavern.
I don't really know a lot about Jack Gage, but I do know that the murals that they have behind the bar in there were originally from England, and they're only two blocks from our house, so we walk up there quite frequently. Their sliders, I think, are some of the best in town. They're one of the few sliders where you actually want to eat the bread. In fact, I really think their appetizers are some of the best. Yeah, the chicken lollipops are really interesting. They take a drumstick and they somehow manipulate the meat to make it look just like a round lollipop. And they serve it with something I've never heard of before, a white barbecue sauce, as opposed to a red barbecue sauce. And then their portobello fries are delicious. Deep fried with this really good sauce with just a little bit of a tang to it. I think it's got some paprika in it. I like their chicken and waffles, which is highly unusual. It's quite good. But for dessert, I usually just get their little inexpensive little mini chocolate sundae. It's served in a little martini glass about this big. Really cute. And just sometimes you just want a little something sweet to finish off a meal, and it's just perfect. But I like it because it's two blocks from my house, and I can walk up there and just relax, and the people there are great. They always open the door for you when you walk there, and they always welcome you.
Well, Jacob, how about you? How was your experience at Jack Gage?
Well, I went in there, and I'd say every piece that me and my guests ordered was up to snuff, right? The regional specialties, which maybe you didn't pick up on this kind of flair, that he has things from New Orleans, from Maryland, from the Deep South.
I did mean to say that. It does have that southern twist.
Regional flair to it, and he pulls it off really well. I mean, pimento cheese doesn't sound like something you want to eat in a restaurant, but it was the best pimento cheese I found, you know.
We had that, too.
Yeah.
It was. I was not excited about it.
Never
my mother-in-law
that.
Wanted it.
So it's something new for me to try.
It's like something Texas granny is going to make for me.
It was really good. It was a really, really pleasant surprise.
What else did you have?
Well, that was actually the second time that I went because I loved it so much. My husband and I went the first time without our child, and we got an appetizer that I absolutely loved. And it was a fried green tomato and crab meat tower.
Stack, yes.
Oh my gosh.
That's really interesting. Again, unusual.
We ate every last drop of it, and the sauce that it comes with, I think it's a sweet mustard aioli. Mm. I could eat it by the spoonful. My husband actually got the cheese and shrimp grits, or southern shrimp
grits. And they're
very
good.
Oh my God. I've never had grits that I liked either. And I wanted to steal his plate. It just seems to be a theme for me.
Yeah, it does. Well, you're identifying what's best. That's all.
Yeah, and it was
just doing
great.
A quick survey.
The second time we went, he got the crab mac and cheese, and he loved that too.
Yeah, I got the crab mac and cheese too. Delightful. The waitress came to me. She's like, "Oh, you can have a half order if you want." And it ended up being this huge portion of it. Everybody on the table could share it anyway, and for half the price, you can't go wrong with something like that.
So what else did you have, Jacob?
I had the chicken and waffles, can't fault it. Maybe would have rather had chicken wings instead of chicken breast, which is what they do it with. But it was still really good, you know. I would go back just to have that, especially after maybe I drank a little bit too much or something like that. It seems like that kind of food. There was a lot of good things going on with the menu.
And Lindsay, how was your chicken?
Well, it was marked as the house specialty, and it was the only item on the menu that had a huge box on its own. It had a really smoky flavor. I really liked it, and the skin was crispy. It was really, really moist. The sides were not my favorite, but you know, the chicken was wonderful. So
wonderful. Well, Jacob, what did you think of bang for the buck?
I think that they do a lot better value-wise than what you'd find on the Plaza. Jack Gage really wins the day, keeps it realistic.
And Susan, bang for the buck?
I think it's good bang for the buck. I really do.
I definitely go back for happy hour.
I definitely do. And I think their wine is not half price, but their well drinks.
Yeah, exactly.
Their well drinks are half price. Yeah. So. Yeah.
And Lindsay, bang for the buck?
So I think for my husband and I, for appetizer, two dinners, and he had a beer, I think it was around $55, which is great.
Yeah.
It's hard to find that when it's good food.
Indeed. Well, Susan, it was your restaurant. Please sum it up for us.
I do think, as I say, their food quality is high. The wait staff is very friendly and very helpful. And I just really enjoy all the tastes of the different kinds of food they have there. I just think it's just a really nice, nice place to go. I just love it. So
wonderful. Jacob?
Jack Gage kind of blew me away. I had really low expectations, and they really went above and beyond what I expected. If you can pull off something expansive like that and really do a good job, I say more power to you.
Wonderful. Lindsay?
I obviously love Jack Gage because I went twice instead of just once. And I think, you know, there's something for everyone. So if you like fried chicken, get chicken and waffles. If you want a nice, fancy scallop dish, that's what I got the second time, and it was fabulous. So I think it's a great restaurant, and I'm so glad that someone showed it to me.
Wonderful. Well, go once or twice yourself at Jack Gage American Tavern, 5031 Main Street, Kansas City, Missouri. Their number is 816-531-4243. They're open Monday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 1 a.m., Saturday from 9 a.m. to 1 a.m., and Sunday, 9 a.m. to midnight. Reservations are accepted, and the average dinner tab per person without drinks is $15.
Everyone knows the bottle wine is the best wine, isn't it?
Yeah, maybe, for some people. But Bordeaux's gotten really stupid expensive. I mean, hundreds of dollars per bottle. I mean, if you're gonna buy the bottle, give me a call. But there's so many labels in Bordeaux, and they don't all cost $300 and $400 a bottle. In fact, some of them are under $20 a bottle in vintages like 09 or 07 or 05. And maybe it's not the greatest Bordeaux you're ever gonna have, but they still, after all, are Bordeaux. High school English teacher Lindsay McFall says even her grammar goes to pieces, describing her pick in Waldo. Participles dangle and prepositions are hanging when she visits the 75th Street Brewery.
We opened the doors in 1993, and at that time, the craft beer movement was in full swing. So we decided that Kansas City needed a brew pub and decided to open up shop in Waldo. The ambiance is something like a cozy warehouse, for lack of a better term.
Well, the 75th Street Brewery offers upscale casual dining, American cuisine with European influences. We offer everything from steaks to pizzas to a variety of sandwiches, and we offer features every day with local meats and vegetables that are available. And then, of course, as always, we try to pair those with beers that really match with them.
Being Kansas City's first brew pub, I think that says a lot. If you're going to check out a brewery in Kansas City, then you've got to start here.
We make a range of different beers, and it's super fresh. I mean, it's approximately 2 weeks from grain to tap.
We want you to feel like you're at home when you're here. All the while, our servers and bartenders are educating you on our food, our handcrafted ales, and we'd like you to leave feeling a little more relaxed than when you came in from the artisanal beers.
Okay, Lindsay, use your three adjectives to describe 75th Street Brewery, if you can.
Family friendly, diverse,
just
delicious.
Keep going. Oh, okay.
So I chose 75th Street Brewery because I do like more casual restaurants with a family feel, and we have a five-year-old, so we need to be able to go to restaurants that cater kind of to families. The beers are delicious, they change all the time, and they are not really satisfied with keeping everything the same. They're always looking for ways to improve. So their menu has recently been revamped, but if I had to pick something that I would recommend for anyone, it would probably be the roasted chicken, slow roasted, and there's a jus that goes over it that is really good. And I think it's served over like crispy Yukon potatoes. So it's one of my favorite dishes. I think the potatoes are really, really good.
I'm going to try that next time.
Yeah. Then my husband loves a dish that they have that's the 7-hour roasted pork. And it's served over green onion risotto, I believe. That's his go-to dish. I mean, they have small plates. So I had the garlic frites, which I love.
Garlic and salt.
Yeah.
And fried beans.
And crumb.
I believe we have everything important in one dish.
Yes, and a huge cone. I mean, they're never ending. You can never get to the bottom of them. So my husband loves the Scotch egg.
Oh, yeah.
Which, oh my gosh.
I had, I grew up with Scotch egg. And I had that, and I liked it. I thought
and it passed your muster.
It wasn't as good as I grew up with.
Oh, understandable.
But it was pretty darn good.
Well, Jacob, any favorites you found?
I've been going to 75th Street Brewery ever since I've been allowed to drink, basically. And recently, they've really upped their game, right? They've invested a lot of money into their outside area. They've switched up their menu a lot. Recently, I've been obsessed with, like, eating mussels with white wine and shallots and this sort of thing. Well, they do mussels there in more the Belgian style with the beer and the... I would totally switch over to that style of doing mussels. It was delicious. It had perfect fries in the cone sort of vessel. It made me feel like I was in, like, Cologne or Belgium or something like this. I had a pizza. I had pretzels with beer.
So what was on your pizza? What kind of pizza did you get?
I think it was fig prosciutto, something like that. So it's one of these kind of high-end combinations that people are getting into now. And to me, that works perfectly with there.
Well, Susan, what was your meal like?
I was very impressed. I thought their menu was extremely eclectic. I mean, if you can't find something you like to eat there, there's something wrong with you. Yeah. I did the Scotch eggs, and then I had shrimp with a risotto, which was good, but you got four little tiny shrimp, and it was like $9.
I had the same thing.
Yeah, and I thought that was, it was very good. But then I had... the pecan crusted goat cheese salad, which again was the same thing. It was delicious, but you got a little piece of goat cheese and you had all this lettuce and you just didn't have enough bites of goat cheese to go with the lettuce. But it was served with peeled orange slices, which was really good with the goat cheese. And then I had bread pudding and it was good, but they had, I think it was microwaved and they'd microwaved it just a shade too long. But other than that, I liked it. And I did have raspberry beer. Even though I'm not a beer drinker, I thought you can't go to a brewery without trying beer. And I was pleasantly surprised. I was actually able to drink the whole glass of beer, which I don't think I've ever done in my life. So,
well, I certainly was going to ask about that. What did everybody have for beer? I mean, if you're at 75th Street Brewery, you're checking out the board, seeing what they're doing, what's unusual, what they typically have. And
they're smart. They give sampling sizes. Mm-hmm. So I just ordered every single beer, right? And they brought me out.
Only for research purposes. Yeah. I really think that was good of you to take one for the team
day,
like
right?
that. Yeah. And did beer make it onto your palate?
It did. I am a beer drinker, so of course I love 75th Street Brewery. But I had a blueberry wheat. It was their seasonal. And
they didn't have that.
And it was really good. And then I got Old Trusty, the Cowtown wheat, which is my favorite.
Yeah,
so.
It's a good beer. It's a well-balanced beer. Now, Susan, what did you think of the value there?
I thought the value was quite good. I was impressed with it, yes.
And bang for the buck, Jake?
I think if you're able to do a pizza that has some gourmet ingredients on it for the same price that a national chain does it, it gives you a sense of just how cheap the ingredients the national chain might be using are, right? And to me, I think they're priced right. And again, with the beer, to be able to have a smaller portion of it and not to pay full price, to me, that's something that I'm really looking for.
Indeed. Well, Lindsay, this was your restaurant. Why don't you just sum it up for us?
Okay. 75th Street Brewery, I think, is in a great location. They have a very diverse menu, and it's a family-friendly place, but also... you know, at night it turns into kind of a more pub feel. So I think it's a wonderful place for the money and great food.
Excellent. Jacob?
I would go there specifically for things like mussels, and it has some of these continental flares, and I like the word gastropub that they use a lot in England. To me, it fits our version of gastropub, but we don't even need the word because we've been dealing with microbrews for dozens of years now.
And Susan?
I think what my husband and I liked the most was that they had such a large variety of small plates. And so we were able to try a number of things that were you know, tasty and different and get a real variety for not, you know, all. I think we ordered six things altogether, and plus a glass of wine for him and a beer for me. And I think the check was $60, which is good for six items and two drinks. So, yeah.
Well, you decide for yourself at 75th Street Brewery, 520 West 75th Street in Kansas City, Missouri. The phone number is 816-523-4677. They're open Sunday through Wednesday, 11 a.m. to midnight, and Thursday through Saturday, 2:30 a.m. Reservations for large groups are accepted, and the average dinner tab per person without drinks is $15.
So on this week's show, we featured the 715 in Lawrence, Kansas. Jacob said you must try the cutting-edge cuisine. Lindsay said she'll definitely trek back for the food. And Susan said it's got an impressive variety on the menu. And we featured Jack Gage off the Plaza. Jacob said it blew him away with quality. Lindsay said she loved it so much, she reviewed it twice. And Susan said it's her home away from home. Finally, we featured 75th Street Brewery in Waldo, and Jacob said they've stepped up to be a gastropub. Lindsay said you can't go wrong with a rewards card, and Susan said she loved the variety of small plates. We've had a wonderful time this week. I want to thank my guests, Susan Smith, Jacob Bosch, and Lindsay McFall. Please join us next week for three new guests recommending three of their favorite restaurants right here on Check Please Kansas City. I'm Doug Frost, and I will see you then. And
cheers.
Cheers.
Primary production underwriting for Check Please Kansas City has been provided by Bank of America, Bank of Opportunity. Additional funding for Check Please Kansas City is provided by 360 Vodka, the world's first eco-friendly premium vodka, saving the planet one glass at a time.